I can be negative for a moment. It's good to be whole. I don't have all the answers. I think it would be arrogant, of course, once I have all the answers. I hope I can develop interesting questions. I hope that I could show perhaps some different ways of looking at things that you know, isn't commonly seen. And my basic topic is, you know, is there something within the Christian philosophy that might be unique in the context of discuss racial issues? So that's going to be where I'm going to jump off at as far as doing. It's been a long time since I walked through this campus. I graduated in the 90s to get my doctorate degree here, a lot of construction. I actually was, last year, did speak on research at Texas A&M. And you know, with all the construction here, this campus is still prettier than that ugly maroon campus. I couldn't say anything at that time because, you know, I wanted to be able to fly out and survive. It wouldn't look good bringing a black guy in to talk about racial issues and him dying in College Station. Said, oh, first of all, no, he insulted the Aggies. I want to talk about this topic, and I'm just going to lay out some groundwork for us. I assume you all are here because you have some interest in racial issues. And your interest in racial issues probably means you have some knowledge of what's happening. I just want to go ahead and lay out a few things so that we're all on the same page. Then I want to kind of look at, you know, is there something unique in Christian-based philosophy that leads in a different direction we're going? My best contention is that we're not getting anywhere on racial issues. I remember, what was it, 7 years ago when then-Senator Obama became President Obama, and people were talking about, wow, we've elected a black president. This is going to be a watershed racial moment. And maybe it was, but maybe it was for reasons that we didn't anticipate. The racial issues did not go away because we had a black president. Now, don't get me wrong, that was meaningful. That meant something. One could say, oh, that's nothing. But it was not a problem solver. So, well, I tell you, I don't have all the answers. Maybe I can provoke us to think a little bit closer about how to solve the problems. Okay, there we go. Okay. We live in a racialized society. This is a society where race matters profoundly for differences in black experiences, black opportunities, and social relationships. In other words, race does matter. Who I am, in part, has been shaped by my race. I'm not saying it's the only thing, or the most important thing, but it has been shaped. My life chances, to some degree, have been shaped by my race. If I have the time, I can go back and tell you a little bit about myself, my life history, and why my race is mattered to where I'm at. Even though, by most standards, I'm fairly successful, things could have been different. My social relationships definitely have mattered because of my race. And you might think, well, this is an older guy. Of course I'm going to say that. It matters for younger people, too. We live in a racialized society that race is impacting our society. As a result of that, there are contrasting views about racism. Now, I'm going to come back to this in a little bit. Well, one view is that racism is something that's overt and only done from one individual to another individual. In other words, this definition of racism is, if I mistreat a person because of their race, that is racism. If I don't hire you because you are black, white, Hispanic, what have you, that's racism. And that's how racism is defined by many people in our society. The other view is that racism is structural as well as individualistic. And social institutions can perpetuate racism even when the individual does not intend to be racist. What many race scholars talk about is institutional or structural racism, that our structures can have an impact on race. Since the controversy right now is on shootings, let me just give you one example of how this might look like. Police officers often don't just enforce the overt laws. but not just rape and murder, things like that, but also rewrite carbon nuisance laws. Sometimes make money for the community, you know, whether you can sell cigarettes or things of this nature. When they enforce nuisance laws, because African Americans tend to be lower socioeconomic status, tend to be grouped together in what's been called an apartheid situation in the United States, they disproportionately bear the brunt of these nuisance laws. Police officers interact with blacks more to enforce these laws than they would with whites. Those factors by themselves would mean that even if police, even if we assume that police are not out to get blacks, but if you interact with people trying to force a law more on them, then you're going to have more tension, more resistance, you're going to have more of a chance for conflict, more of a chance for a possible police shooting. That's an example of structural or institutional racism. The second group of people say that's a problem as well. You don't have to personally be racist for this to be an issue, but if you live in a social structure which creates these problems, that's problematic as well. Okay, so here's two ways in which groups have looked at racism. Now, what happened a few years ago was, because I study these issues, I tend to watch a lot of TV. And I don't tend to watch things such as, what, Honey Boo Boo, or you know, is it that salon? Like that. I tend to watch, I'm one of those people, I'm one of those nerds, okay? I know it doesn't look like it. I know it looks like I'm cool, but I'm actually one of those nerds. And I like to watch, you know, I switch back and forth, you know, MSNBC and Fox and CNN and, you know, on the weekends I go to TV and stuff like that. And now I'm trying to follow the game. And let's not talk about talking, please. But that's what I tend to do. And as I was doing this, I was watching people talk about racial issues. And I came up with four models that people use to address racial issues. So I'm going to show you the models I came up with a few years ago, and then I'm going to really simplify it, because I think today it kind of come down to two. But let me show you the first four that I came up with. Okay. Colorblindness, multiculturalism, and conformity, and white responsibility. So I'll briefly define each one, and you can see where I'm going. What I would call these is what sociologists call ideal types. They're sort of like examples, even exaggerations, to sort of try to illustrate how people are talking about racial issues. Because what I found is when people were on these shows and racial issues came up, they usually conformed to one of these models, and maybe some mixture of one or the other. For example, some people talk about colorblindness, argue that we'll have racial reconciliation is ignore race and forget the past historical discrimination. Contrary to the advances we've made and acting in a colorblind manner is the best way to overcome racism. And this is a model that people use, that they talk about, look, if you want to get rid of racism, if you want to live in peace and harmony with everyone in our society, stop talking about race. We're all humans. I did on my first day of class, when I teach race ethnicity, I asked the students to have them guess what race I am. And I get some creative answers. I mean, you know, most of the time they're the boring African American black, you know, African American black. Every now and then I get Jamaican and, you know, Nicaraguan and, you know, I'm trying to think of that. I think I have gotten Middle Eastern a couple of times. If my class is big enough, I will get people to say, human race. In other words, you're racist. You don't have a race, you're a human race. And I always say this, you know, that's great personal philosophy. And that's terrible sociology. Because race does matter. It does have an impact. I mean, sure, you know, there's personal philosophy, we're all human, you know, how can I argue that? But studying social sciences, that's not the way out. But that's colorblindness. That's what that is. That's if we ignore race, it won't have any problems. The next model is angle conformity. And it's similar to colorblindness, but there is a little bit of difference that I picked up. Encourage racial minorities to accept European American values Anti-racial strife is helping minorities imitate how whites have moved up the economic and social ladder. So there are people who got these shows, they talk about, look, the problem is, you know, these economic disparities. We agree. And you look at the broken homes in these minority communities, and you look at their inability to get into educational settings, and things of this nature. They also point out how Asian Americans are successful. What we have to do is help them to succeed in our capitalist society. We need to give them the encouragement, the training, and then they'll succeed. Then we'll have more economic parity, and then we'll, you know, all these racial problems go away. So it's somewhat like colorblindness, but not quite, because it's not totally ignoring race, but it is saying that if people of color act like whites, then things will get better. So that's another model that you can pick up when you hear people talk about these issues. Multiculturalism deals with racial alienation by emphasizing the value and worth of minority cultures. Thus, racial minority individuals and their subcultures are held in low esteem by the dominant culture, so we must find worth in these individuals and cultures. Almost all college campuses have multicultural programs. Multicultural programs are those programs where we have Cinco de Mayo or Kwanzaa. You know, we're going to celebrate all these different cultures. We're going to say, you know, we're not just going to celebrate just the dominant culture, we're going to celebrate all cultures. That's what the problem is that we have denigrated cultures of color, and by raising all cultures up, we are going to then be able to hopefully respect one another, help each other succeed, and deal with some of the problems of racism. So this is a multicultural approach that some people will have. And the problem that they see is when we don't do this, when we value the dominant culture above all other cultures. This sort of model clearly would be clashing with that anti-conformity model. When those people get on the show, all of a sudden the fireworks start coming out. So this is a multiculturalism type of model. And then the last one, you know, and the other ones are terms that other people have. I've been thinking of a good term for this one, so I made mine up. My original term was whites are evil, and then someone said, well, that's a little strong. True story. So I said, okay, I'll just change the white responsibility. Locates racial problems totally within majority group cultures and individuals. Racial minorities cannot be racist since they lack the economic and social power of whites. Solutions revolve around total empowerment of racial minorities. So whenever you hear someone say, blacks can't be racist, chances are they're tying to this particular model. They're saying the problem is whites. Whites need to get their act together, and they need to change society. The responsibility of color is to, you know, tell them things that need to change, but until the whites get their power, we're going to have this sort of problem. So this is what I call the white responsibility model. Now, what's happened is I think these four models were probably spot on several years ago, and they still are to varying degrees. But what's happened is the lynch controversy has morphed down to really two basic models. And so I think that when you see this, you'll be able to see it. And let me just sort of illustrate this way. The first basic model is Black Lives Matter. Now, I'm going to have to explain this model to you, because this is on our TV screens, right? The Black Lives Matter take on racial issues, the outrage at the structural problems, at shootings, at whatever racial issues are out there. This has really sort of become the dominant narrative that a lot of people who, remember that slide I had two views of race, and the second view was on structural problems, they gravitated toward sort of Black Lives Matter perspective of it. All right? Now, of course, as Black Lives Matter gained prominence, you had a cure.
Moving against it.
And so, what I call this cure movement is all lives matter. Remember that racism is something that's overt, that from one person to another. If that's where you're at, then you're in all lives matter, which is a direct killer to Black Lives Matter. So what's kind of happened is that these models, which were kind of varied, are in just the way that the discourse has come. I don't have like this great insight as to why it discourse happened this way, but it's really sort of boiling down to, and here's where our argument is going in our country today. And it is an emotional, tenuous time when it comes to racial issues. But Black Lives Matter, I mean, all lives matter. And it appears to me, you know, if I step outside from the conflict and look at it, you know, as a quasi-outsider, which of course is difficult to do, because I'm a citizen in this country and I obviously, you know, have a racial stake in what's happening. But if I do take that, it seems that there's nowhere to go other than to keep fighting. I'm basically killed. And my Facebook friends span the political spectrum, you know, because I tend to be the sort of person that says nuanced things that kind of pisses off the right hand a lot. And so, you know, when I put stuff out there, you know, sometimes my Facebook friends jump all over me, sometimes my friends jump all over me. And I've known from talking to people who are kind of invested in those models how much they hold on to those models, Yeah, and they're convinced that this, you know, if we just do what we want, racial problems will go away. You know, if you just correct, you know, here in our agenda, you put this agenda, which won't go away. No, if you ignore race, racial problems will go away. And looking at it as an outsider, I think both are wrong. Both are wrong. They will not go away between one side or the other. In fact, you're just getting more and more fighting. Is there a way away from this? Is there a way we can challenge this and move to a place where we're dealing with racial issues? And here's where I turn to a Christian type of philosophy. Now, I'm not a theologian. I don't come on the TV. You know, I study religion. I teach sociology religion class. I teach race and religion. They say you shouldn't talk about race and religion by company, and I teach it. So, you know, that's more about me than anything else, I guess. But looking at the basis of Christianity and the Christian philosophy, I do think there's an idea that gives us insight into what's happening and maybe a way forward. Unfortunately, it's not this way forward where I can say, we just do this and it's all solved. But it may give us a direction that might help us to move away from this. So let's look at this. Well, all these models ignore, I think, is an important concept in this Christian philosophy, and that's the concept of human depravity. This is a key difference, I think, between a more Christian mindset towards moving forward and a more, if you will, more secular humanistic mindset moving forward. In the humanistic framework, humans are perfectible. In other words, if we educate people enough, if we give people enough training, we can reach out towards some level of perfection. In the Christian mindset, humans are not perfectible. And in fact, let me just go ahead and give you some basis for that, and then I'll discuss the implication of that as the surgeon's models. So, just a few scriptures up here, you know, because I'm not a theologian, so I don't know all the best theological works on this particular topic. But just some scriptures, because I think this is an idea that comes again and again and again. You know, in Genesis, the words all the greatest of families great throughout the earth. Every intention of thoughts and heart was evil continuously. There's a pessimistic view, Christian view, on what we do with our hearts. You know, there's not this trust that, well, if we give the person all these right options, they're going to make the right options. It's a much more pessimistic view. None is righteous, no one understands, no one seeks for God. The natural man does not accept the things of the Spirit of God. They are folly to him. He does not even understand them because they are spiritually discerned. So the idea is that if we are left to our own devices, we will tend to be selfish. We will tend to be, reject the things that may help others, or seek our own. You know, we all have our own issues, our own problems. They will tend towards our brain. Some of us are greedy, and some of us, have more of a different personality. That we tend towards those things. The idea then that mystical education is unaffectable is challenged by this sort of idea. Now, why is this important? Well, let me just look at what R.C. Sproul says about human depravity, and then this will lead us to why I think this explains the concept we're seeing. Sproul argues that humanism considers human beings to be basically good. Now, this is one of those questions that is a fundamental assumption. Are humans basically good, or are they not basically good? The Christian philosophy is that they are not. The human philosophy is that they are. That if we somehow train people the correct way, they will be basically good. Christianity, in a sense, permeates the core of our life. So, I once heard a pastor explain it this way: is, it's not that we're sinners because we sin. Because we're sinners. That's why it's not that we sin because we're sinners. See, that's not a good pastor. But we're sinners because we sin. In other words, it's within us. It's not that, I do something wrong, that means I'm a sinner. That's already within me to do. Sproul says, total depravity is not utter depravity. And this is one of the mistakes I think some people make of this concept. We're not as wicked as we possibly could be. So it's not saying that we can't do anything good. But it says that, it's in our basic nature. And chances are, chances are not good, that we'll do anything good. And that radical corruption points to the core sinfulness of our hearts. Now, what does all this mean on racial issues? Racial issues mean that we're alien from one another. Means that different groups have reasons not to trust each other. So when we look at, the basic fight that I just showed you, Black Lives Matter versus All Lives Matter. And I'm going to ask you to try to do this, and you may favor one or the other. I'm going to try to do this without, favoring your group for a second. Neither group will trust the other. The All Lives Matter group will not trust the Black Lives Matter group to construct rules that will be fair to everyone. And the Black Lives Matter group will not trust the All Lives Matter group to create a society that will be fair to everyone. And the reason why is that if the Christian philosophy is right, and we understand that in our core, we have a certain selfishness, we know that others have it too. And we don't want to give our power to someone who then hurt us. And that's why, if we continue on the pace that we're at, we're just fighting All Lives Matter versus Black Lives Matter, that we're just going to keep fighting. One side will get the upper hand for a little while, but they don't have to keep fighting because they don't trust them. They don't think that group has in their interest anything. They're just going to create the rules that they want and force it on the other group. Now, if you are with one group or the other, you immediately say, no, that's really not, we're really not trying to do that. The other side is not going to trust you unless they have a reason to trust you. And hashtag apathy does not give people reason to trust. So, how do we get away from this? First, we have to decide we want to get away from this. We have to decide if we're open to get away from this. And if we are there steps we can take to possibly get away from this? My suggestion is something called a mutual obligations approach. Now, I say the Christian-based approach does not mean you have to be a Christian to take this approach or benefit from it. But it is a Christian-based approach where we recognize that people of all races have a sin nature that has to be accounted for.
That's the Christian part.
Now, you may want to say, well, I don't believe in sin nature, I don't believe in God. Just say, you know, you evolved to be selfish. You know, that could fit within the evolutionary framework. Selfishness is very useful in the evolutionary framework. Thus, everyone has an obligation to work towards healthy interracial communications to solve racial problems. Going back to watching CNN and Fox and MSNBC and all that sort of nerdy stuff that I did. Sometimes I switch the channels between longer tapes too, so longer for life. When I watch them talk about racial issues, you know, I get to keep people saying, we've been talking for years, and I want to get on the TV, no, you're not. Because we've all been in fights when we're yelling at the person, or they're yelling at us, or some of you aren't yellers, so you're just talking intensely to the person. And they're talking intensely back to you. And what you're doing is you're waiting for the other person to shut up because you're preparing your answer. And that's exactly what's happening. We are not talking about racial issues in a healthy way in our society. I don't know if we ever have. Obviously, with our history, you know, it's a reason why there's no opportunity to talk about healthy because those who look like me had an opportunity to really verbalize our concerns. But now we can. But we're not talking in a healthy way. How do we do that? Well, this is what I would call a mutual obligations approach. You know, ideally, you know, 50 years ago, it was accepted to think of white as superior. You know, you had all of the family, teach all of the family. When I say that to my students, I don't even expect them to know about it. You know, I know that that's before the time. But it was a show where I had guys with Protestant races, and no one blinked because that's, you had to write that out there. And they were not stigmatized. Today, I tell my class, the worst thing you can be, the worst thing you can call in our society that's legal is a racist. So I think the only thing worse than a racist are things are evil. You know, child molester, murder, rapist, you know. I mean, the worst thing you can call that's legal is a racist. So that's stigmatized. People, even if they have racism, don't want to engage in it overtly because they want to escape the stigma. It would be nice if we begin to work towards a society that is a pressure people to have honest, healthy communication in such a way. Now that's a long ways off, I know, you know, humble beginnings. But that's, I guess if there's a dream, that would be my dream at this point. Okay, now this is all great in theory. Are there practical steps we might want to consider taking? So let me go ahead and suggest a couple of ways of looking at it. First of all, I'll look at institutional problems. What does model mean for institutional problems? And then what does model mean for interpersonal relationships? Okay? So I just want to, you know, how would we do things differently, in other words, if we took what I'm saying seriously and tried to implement it? And I'm just gonna be honest, the model I'll show you, I don't know anyone who's done it. So I can't tell you, well, you know, I know back, you know, over in Ohio, they actually did this and did this stuff. My co-author, Mike Emerson, and I are actually looking for an opportunity to try to implement this at some municipality somewhere. So if you know someone who says, hey, we have a racial problem, we'll work next, we'll try anything, you know, we might be stupid enough to actually come and try this. We'll see. Okay. Let's say there is some sort of, you know, the latest thing has been on police shootings. And so let's recognize that there are two parties with great interest here. And while I don't want to oversimplify it, I say it's just blacks, but let's keep it simple and say, you know, there's the black community that's concerned about police shootings, and there's the police officers. And they both have something at stake in creating new rules in order to hopefully, if not eliminate, reduce the chances of that sort of violence. So how do we approach that? Well, the first step is to actually define the problem. Whenever I try to do a project, I try to create, you know, I try to define what is my research problem, what I'm actually looking at, what I'm actually looking for. Just as if you're in a relationship and you're having an argument, what counsel will tell you is what's totally unproductive is to bring everything into that argument. You know, well, I don't hear, but what you did, you know, that didn't have me anywhere. So you can't solve everything at once. So let's solve this one issue. You know, now, the thing is, connecting that issue, there are directly relevant to it, and that's family. So, you know, if we're looking at an issue on policing, then that's the problem we should define that we need to solve as precisely as possible. And then, Michael and I talk about identifying the critical core. We get so busy arguing about who's right and who's wrong, we forget what we have in common. You know, if you go into the black community, they don't want the police gone. I mean, you can find a few radicals that will say that. But you're coming out in America because no one wants the police gone, because they know that there are some people out there who do them harm. So policing, to some degree, you know, there's some agreement. You know, we have to have the police in a situation to where blacks are not unnecessarily harassed and definitely not killed unless there's a situation where, you know, obviously if something's done, that's the whole situation altogether. But, you know, there are things that can agree upon what we want. Let's find out what we want, what we have in common together before we move on. And then recognize the cultural and racial differences at play. And here's where, you know, if we had activists and police union in a room, I would ask them, look, you know, tell me what you want to the activists, and then tell me what you want to the police officers. And then let's see what the differences are. But I wouldn't just let them off that way. You see, when I said to black activists, tell me what you want, before the police unions got a chance to respond, I was like, what did you hear? Tell me in your own words what they want. And then when they say that, I was going to ask, is that correct? And they can say, no, that's not correct, or yes, you got it. Then you do the reverse. The reason why I would want to do that is, I don't want people to just say, all right, this is what I want, I'm going to build around that, because that gets back to the human capacity aspect of it. We're going to build solutions for us. But if you don't understand what the other parties want, how do you find a solution that people can buy into? So it's important that we understand one another. So, you, once you get to the point where we understand the differences, now we have something to work with. Now this is the step that I just like never see occur. People make demands, but they don't develop ideas that deal with the concerns of others. So after dealing with both groups, the trick is, okay, you've heard what each one wants. What do you want? But in what you want, tell me how you're going to address their concerns. Now, it's naive to think that the way they're going to address your concerns, they're going to go, yahoo, yes, you got it, yes, we love you. That's probably not going to happen. But it's going to be closer. They're going to have to at least consider other issues other than their own group. And why is it important? I go back to the gravity. The fact that if, you know, the Christian philosophy is correct, I'm going to tend to look after my interests and ignore the interests of others. All of a sudden, now I must take into consideration the interests of others. I have to build a solution that at least takes their interests into consideration. And so whereas before, you know, they're this far apart, preferably this far apart. Perhaps they're this far apart. Who knows, they're at least closer together. At that point, maybe we have a shot at working towards a solution that can attempt to fight off. You know, I argue that the current way we're doing things, Black Lives Matter, all lives matter, we can have this fight from now, who knows, till my son's kids, and their kids, and their kids, and their kids, and their kids, and we still have this fight. Because as long as we're seeing solutions in this sort of bifurcated world, we'll keep fighting. But maybe if you find a solution where, you know, okay, you meet some of our needs, or meet some of your needs, then groups from both sides are invested in the solution. I believe that only at that point, can we have a solution that's stable. Where you have a solution, and you don't have half the country trying to undermine the solution. Sure, you're going to have some people don't like it. There's no one who's going to come up with a solution there and say, no, that's great. But if the core leaders are going to both buy into the solution and not feel like they're forced into it, we have a solution that might endure. Otherwise, what's the definition of insanity and the same thing over and over again, getting the same sort of different result? You know, that's what I see as far as this sort of conflict. So, dealing with interracial problems, these are the sort of solutions that that I would like to see tried and implemented that has the framework of mutual accountability approach. Now, most of us are not in a position to work on something like this, obviously. So what can we do to create an atmosphere where racial issues don't have to become this hot button where we have to, you know, get into Twitter wars and Facebook wars and things of this nature? Let me suggest something. Let me suggest the practice of active listening. I do find it disheartening to enter into conversations with individuals on racial issues and to quickly learn that there's going to be no progress made. Because of my work as a social scientist, we're not allowed to interview. No matter, and this isn't just on racial issues, on anything. I have to be an active listener. If you take a qualitative research course, they talk about how you can actively listen. Because in that role, the only thing I want is to learn what that person has to give me. I'm not looking to convince them of anything. In fact, that would be unethical for me to do that in my role as a researcher. I'm not looking to twist what they have to say to anything. I want as accurate a perspective as I possibly can get. So because of this, and because I have studied racial issues, I have engaged in active listening to people of a wide variety of different perspectives. And it does shape how I look at things. It does make me more aware of why people are approaching things in a certain way. And I just wonder if we did this more, whether or not we would change the dynamic of understanding the racial hostility in our society. It's not going to change overnight, obviously. But I just wonder what could happen. So let's look at the implications of this. How would we do this? I wrote an article in an online journal called The Stream a few weeks ago talking about what you do about race relations. That's a more conservative type of journal. But the article was something that could apply to a person no matter what their political persuasion. It's basically what you do about racial relations. It was about activism. So I suggested this. Find someone you disagree with greatly on racial issues. Now, I'm talking about someone in your social network. I'm not talking about someone else. Hey, you seem like you don't agree with me. That's a good way, you know, to get a punch in the face. No, we probably, and if you don't have someone in your social network you disagree with, then you probably need to expand your social network, in all honesty. You know, because you're not getting enough ideas from people who disagree with you. We probably have, maybe an uncle or a friend that we know, or someone like that we disagree with. Find someone you disagree with, but you know you disagree with, you've heard of, you saw that Facebook post, you went, oh gosh, you know, why are you posting that again? You know who this person is. Alright, there's probably multiple people. If there's not, expand your social network. Get out more. Stop being afraid people disagree with you.
I am.
Have lunch or coffee. Now this assumes that they are, they live in the same city as you do, because I'm not flying over to North Dakota to have coffee with someone. But find some way in which you can have a chance to have that sort of one-on-one time. I would not do this in a Facebook discussion unless it's a one-on-one discussion where only you two are communicating, because what happens in the office is third and fourth parties jump in and then it all works out. And that's not true. You're not looking for an argument right now. That's the key. You're not looking for an argument right now. So have lunch or coffee. If they're rich, have them pay. If you're rich, you pay. But if you're both not rich, then that's true. Listen to their perspective. So, have lunch, coffee, say, you know, I know that we don't always agree on this whole Black Lives Matter stuff, but I just want to understand, you know, why do you support them so much? You know, or I know that, you know, I sometimes come off and talk about all lives matter, but I just want to understand, you know, why do you post that? I mean, where are you trying to get at it? Now, you've argued before that might be a little bit defensive. So you have to reassure me, I do not want to argue. I'm not going to, you know, I'm not thinking about a comeback. I just want to understand why you think the way you do on this subject. So, listen to their perspective. This is where you price active listening. You're talking to, they are satisfied to understand their perspective. So, when they say, well, you know, this is how I feel about Black Lives Matter, then you say, okay, here's what I hear you saying. I hear you saying that you feel that the police don't have a lot of respect for African Americans, that they would treat you different if you're white. And because of this, you know, you feel like you have to stand up for Black Lives Matter. You have that tension right here on this issue because it's so vitally important. Now they may say yes, or they may say no, you missed this because it's not just this issue, it's also tied to a larger disrespect Black from seeing in our society. And here, you might want to say, okay, can you help me understand this? You know, what do you mean by disrespect? Give me an example of this. You know, really play the sociologist, if you will. Maybe this is a pitch, and we all need to take sociological methods. Probably have our discourse a whole lot in our society. But really try to draw them out and understand where they're coming from. Your purpose is simply to understand where they're coming from. Now, if they're willing to listen to you, great. Otherwise, let it go. Go to some other topic. Say, oh, yeah, how's your parents doing? You know, or go to bed, you know. Do you think that the Longhorns can sweep the Big 12 conference this year? You know, go to talk with all that you agree on or anything like that. They want to do you for great. What you don't want to do is, okay, I listen to you, they didn't listen to me. They may want to, they may not want to. But they should not feel pressure all of a sudden to engage in that sort of conversation. Because that may shape how they're going to approach the conversation. In fact, if they may say, look, you know, why are you doing this? Are you my needles on YouTube? You say, no, you don't have to. You don't have to listen to what I want to understand where you're coming from. This is for my own education. And so I can understand why you feel the way that you feel. Right? So, you know, but in this, I want to know that I know how you feel. If you want to talk about how I feel, fine. If you don't want to, fine. Either way, it's fine, we're still to be friends. We're still to be my own community about it. No, just mom, it's all gonna do. And do not be obligated to agree with them. Don't fear that if you listen to someone and really hear them out, that means that we accept and agree with them, that we're supporting their perspective. Don't feel obligated that you have to agree with them. You want understanding. You want to know why people come at this the way they come at this and their perspective. So at the end of the day, if you can enunciate clearly why they have killed Rager and you think that they're incorrect, that is okay. That's okay. This is not saying that you have to agree with people that you don't agree with. I think that they stop trying to force them to agree when they don't agree. Because then they just push, you know, if we put pressure on them, they'll agree, but they're really not doing it. And the first chance they get, they'll work against that. You know, why do something like this? You know, you do this one friend, and you didn't even really get a chance to express yourself. What good is it? The key is it will help you learn to understand the perspectives of those that you probably don't know about. Are we past each other? Is because we never stop to listen to what the person has said. So if you want to understand someone else's perspective, you've got to learn how to listen to them. And if you do this, you know, obviously it'd be great if you did it with three or four people. We can do it with just one person, and you'll probably understand perspective, and you'll learn some things. You might learn that people with a perspective are not all equal. That is something great. Or there's a logic to it. Even if you don't agree with it, there's a logic to why they think the way you're thinking that way. Or, you know, maybe if I was in the other situation, I might think that way too. You start humanizing people this way. Wow, what a concept. We humanize people we disagree with. Helps us to learn to actively listen. And, you know, you may do this on this, and this may actually help you in other areas of your life. You know, get married, they help you stay married. But honestly, this is a very useful skill. I admit that I don't always practice it. I mean, I can train, I can do what I want to do it. I don't always want to do it. Even the gravity, you know, what can I say? I didn't say I was just in front of it. But it actually is a good skill to develop. And it's something that takes practice, takes work. So it actually helps to actively listen. So it'll help us, like, you know, in racial issues, but it may help us in other areas. You know, we definitely have a lot of areas that are polarized in our society. It prepares us to communicate with others when the next racial crisis occurs. You know, I watch activists on all sides of the issues on TV, and I watch them rant and rave, and I instantly know that they're speaking only to people that are going to agree with them. And if you do not agree with them, it just turns you off. Because they do not know how to reach out to people who disagree with them. Why? I think they never actively listen. Either they never actually listen, or they just don't care. They don't care what people disagree with. They want to try to force their ideas off on them. So if we want to communicate, not just with people who are, that's easy. Easy to communicate with people who already agree with us. You know, it's amazing, you know, how smart people are when they agree with us. You know, people that we think are dumb or idiots, also they're brilliant because they agree with us. The hard part is how to communicate to people who don't agree with you. Creates a larger atmosphere for most useful interracial communication. I remember having a conversation with one of my friends and friends and an interracial issue. And I said, look, I think you need to find someone who disagrees with you. He was more of all races matter, right? I think you need to have people listen, because, you know, what you're telling me is that, you know, that these activists don't care about police and they want to be mowed down. Now, you don't have to agree with what the activists want, but I can tell you that's not it. You know, that's not what they don't care about police officers being shot. Or they don't care about black and black violence. I think you need to listen to people a little bit. And his response to me was basically, well, I'll listen to them as long as they agree that all lives matter first. And I said, that exactly is not active listening. And he told me, well, I have active listening, and yet he says, you know, he won't do it unless they already agree with him partially. Then that's not active listening. In an atmosphere, when it's about how we can beat the other person no matter what, we cannot have healthy interracial communication. I can give examples from all sides of this. I think we even know examples from people who agree with us, who've done things that we don't want. You know, they're just going to make people mad. And that's going to be done. We need to create a larger atmosphere where we can have useful interracial communication. Racial accountability model is not a model that tells you, you pass this law, this law, this law, and we have racial harmony. It's a law that says, we don't know what we're going to do, but the way to get there is communicate with each other. Even if, let's say that, you know, that there's plan A out here, and plan A is the plan in the world that we would get to if we had a healthy communication, and this is the plan of policing, where, you know, if we had communication, like I'm just like, okay, I understand, and we need to help out this way. The union say, I understand, we need to help out this way. This is a great plan. If we knew plan A before we even had this communication, we just said, let's implement plan A, we know what would happen. If we just said, let's implement without communication, people are going to go, no, wait a second, this plan doesn't work for me in here. This one does not work for me here. Because they've not bought into it. We have to go through the communication before we have a solution. We can't have a solution without communication. It's not going to work. I believe, because of human pride and our mistrust of others, because of this sort of sin nature that the Christian philosophy does not. So, in that sense, I do think that in a Christian philosophy, there is something we need to have that we're not seeing in our worship discussion today. Whether you're a Christian or not, I hope that this additional element is added to our discussion, because I would like to see us make progress in those relations that we've not made up to this point. Thanks for having me.
Q&A, so if you have any questions or comments that you'd like to make, you raise your hand and I'll bring the microphone to you.
Thank you. We enjoyed your presentation. My question to you is, I am a Christian. However, I'm wondering if having a Christian approach to this is basically not being inclusive to bring others into the discussion.
That's why I talk about the Christian philosophy, but this is something that you don't have to be a Christian in order to do. In other words, you don't have to be a Christian to recognize. If you don't want to use sin nature, I get, our alternative is to say we evolved to have a selfish nature, and then that creates a problem. If you want to put it in another framework, as a Christian, of course, I care about the Christian foundation of it, but as a public policy, if we need to call something else, just so that people can say, okay, this is usable, mutual accountability approach, I'm cool with that too. I do think this lends itself to people who are not Christians actually using it. What you have to recognize is that, if you recognize that humans tend to look out after their interests before the interests of others, that's all you have to recognize, and then you move forward.
I only say that because I have a community that I think would be great for you. However, it's a community that has Jewish people. Mm-hmm. And I think the title in and of itself would turn the conversation on. Because it says Christian approach. That's why I said.
I actually wrote a book with Arts and Press that has a lot of the same philosophy. But it doesn't have a Christian aspect, other than the fact that part of what we found was in multiracial churches. So it's a great academic book, and that's a book, Transinteracial Barriers, that you can take to a Jewish community, and they can talk about how we can use that or don't overcome that. So I appreciate that.
Thanks for speaking. So there are a lot of issues that are kind of inseparable from race in America, like class and socioeconomic status, criminality, a lot of times, statistically at least. And I feel like it's really hard for a lot of, as a white person, white people to like accept a lot of times. So how would you suggest we kind of can like bring the conversation forward to try to like talk about race through these other means, because a lot of times, like, say, Tom Copernic, or whatever his name is, I know a lot of people who see he's protesting race, but they only see the military or something like that, and they'll, like, shut the conversation down.
I mean, that's a good question. To find a problem is going to, because sometimes you define one problem, and other issues will come into it, so practice of class will come into it. My thing is, make sure it pertains to that problem, but if it does, then of course you have to deal with that. The Kaepernick thing is interesting. It's another example of people talking past each other. I haven't paid that much attention to it because honestly, I don't work with football players for understanding racial issues. So it's really not been a big issue. But what I'm more interested in is how people talk about issues than actually know. And if it was done correctly, and I have no faith in it would be done correctly, we actually could have a conversation on that. For example, why is he doing what he's doing? And he's actually listening to figure that out. But then, why do people are offended by that? He's actually listening to figure that out. And then, is there something we can figure out that we can agree upon. I actually think it could happen. Now, I have no expectation that it would happen that way, but I actually think it could happen that way. And you're right, you're bringing up issues other than race, but I think it could be really interesting. Maybe Kaepernick will hire me and Emerson go and mediate that, but not in my breath.
Thank you. I wanted to ask, how do you see other racial minorities fitting into this mutual obligations approach?
Very good question. You know, each issue is distinct. So solutions that come out of the dialogue to whites and blacks may not fit with looking at whites and Hispanics, whites and Asians. And, you know, the thing with Asians and Hispanics is that, you know, there's a lot of immigration issues that have been considered, taken into consideration. I think the best model can work. You know, the model is not about the solution, the model is about the communication. And I think the communication is going to be vital, you know, regardless, learning how to communicate with each other. And that may be really an important part of the issue is that we don't know how to communicate with each other. White and black tends to take a lot of attention away, you know, and there are reasons, and there's obviously reasons why that is. I would argue we probably should pay more attention to that relationship than others, but not just that relationship. And so I think the model could work along those lines. We just have to define the problem then. So the problem is immigration legislation. I think then you're talking about the white Asian or white Hispanic conversation that has to happen.
Actually, I was talking more about how we fit into this mutual
use of being that other
people.
Oh, between minorities. You know, I would argue that we can still have that conversation. It doesn't get a lot of attention, minority-minority tensions. In part, I think minorities feel like, well, we don't want this conflict out in the open because we're more than united front. I definitely think that, you know, we should have some mutual obligation approach as far as communicating with one another. I tend to think that that probably won't happen until we start having whites and minorities first. Because I think there's a fear that if we come out and we air our dirty laundry first, then whites will want to pay attention to us. So I think the reality is we're probably not going to have those conversations with minority until we have a minority with a white. I'm not saying it should be that way, I'm saying that's probably what's going to happen.
The question is, how does a lack of understanding history play into this? For instance, Black Lives Matters. For me, it is not the organization or the woman, but because of the historical perspective that Black Lives didn't have. And so the fact that our country, unlike other countries that had that, like the Nazis, Germany has this museum and they teach this in their classes. And in our educational system, slavery and Jim Crow and all of that really hasn't been taught like it should. So we have this disparity of experience because, you know, it hasn't been taught. So how does that play into it?
Yeah, when I use my research in classes, I have about a three-week section on history of race relations, because I tell my class, we don't understand relations today because we don't understand how we got to it. So that would be hard when actors talk about why they are. Bringing the history is part of what would have to happen. Understanding why people feel the way they do today, then understanding why things have come up. And so I would see that as part of the initial conversation. So that when other parties are then trying to actively listen and describe why we come here. If they don't also talk about the history, then it'll be the responsibility of those who articulate and say, no, you're not getting it. Here's why you're not getting it, because of how we come here.
The problem is there, too, though, among a lot of the blacks, black people, African Americans, so you're going to have this conversation, but you're going to be disabled, and how you can express how you're feeling, because you don't have that reference yourself because of the lack of education on that subject in our country. So how do we even jump that hurdle?
Yeah, I think if we're talking about college education, most college education do cover that fairly well. Apart, I know my school and most schools I come from, I don't think many college education people don't know what Jim Crow is or don't know that aspect. I think we're talking about people, you know, I don't know about high school as much because I've not been there. So I do think that they have an understanding of it. And the people who are leading the movement, I think I have to allow them to articulate what motivates them. If it's not the history that's motivating as much as it is motivating others, then that's their responsibility to articulate that. I don't want to be in a position to say, here's what should be motivating me. But I do think that if they are college educated, then there is an awareness of Jim Crow, of what's happened historically. That's been my experience on college campuses.
That's college campuses is one of us speaking as a community leader. I have an outreach organization in Austin, and recently I visited a small church and put on a Black History program for the children, which is, you know, they have so many questions because there's no way that they're getting this information. And so they hear these things. I know I'm talking about, I'm adding something else that shouldn't be added into it, but education is lacking. Yeah. And I think part of the solution is for community organizations like myself to be more proactive in telling our story. But we want everybody to know the story, because the history is so extremely important. Not just the sugar part of it, but the, you know, which is no sugar part, but even the really tough parts, even more so need to be talked about. And communication and history has to come in there together.
And this could be an issue then that, I mean, if you're unsatisfied with the curriculum, then this should be an issue in which we have a discussion with. This should be an issue in which we bring in that, you know, why are you obsessed with the curriculum? How do other people feel about it? And so actually what might be happening is this, you know, while we deal with these other issues where they're at, perhaps this issue too could be one in which we have a dialogue and try sort of the type of texts that would be very important. So that's, I guess, a way to look at that particular thing. If you're bringing that in and you see these deficiencies in these textbooks, so that I don't know, because I also don't deal with elementary or junior high or high school textbooks.
And this is even with the internment of the Japanese here in this country. A lot of people know about that, the Trail of Tears, and all of this is built up our society. And, you know, we need to not talk about just the good things, but not so good things, because even in families, we have good things and bad things. So that's okay. That's very important.
Great, but because we want to deny some things, it's part of that conversation. Okay, to follow up on your question, when I talk with white folks, often institutional racism isn't recognized. So history, in current history, and I mean in the last 50, but you can go back any degrees. So if we're trying to build a conversation and trying to increase understanding, how can we talk about structural racism in a way, or institutional racism in a way that is compelling and gets in here?
Yeah, that's a good question, because, you know, I deal with structural racism in my class. And I don't deal with it in a single lecture. I deal with it throughout the class. Of course, I have been prisoners for 14 weeks, so I had a chance to hit it again. you know, the conversation, I mean, I'm making this sound, I'm probably making this sound too simple. You know, I understand that, you know, you know, for the sake of trying to explain it, you know, hey, just said what you had to say, you said, you know, probably more likely it is, there's going to be a series of that. And part of that is going to help to inform people all sides how other people see things and why they come to their conclusions. And so, and also, it may actually help, maybe we to articulate our own desires. Because part of it is, if you have to explain something to someone else, now all of a sudden you have to learn how to articulate what you want to someone else. And that's a good skill to develop. And it's good to develop a skill of articulating what you want. And so, if I've made it sound too simplistic, it's in part it's because no one's ever done this. Probably when Mike and I get hired, we're going to discover just how hard this is to actually do. But I do think I still think it would be worth doing, but it's probably more of a series of comments rather than just a single, you know, 5-minute comment now that you hear. That's what I think will probably happen. So in a series, then people will become more and more aware.
Actually, you had your hand up a while. Did you want to make a comment first? Well then, I think I'd like to go back to what the lady in the front was talking about education. I'm a high school teacher, actually, and I teach chemistry, but I also teach forensic science and some other things. And, I'm not sure that you can, I'm not sure, actually I would disagree with you about the college level thing, because as a high achieving high school student, and when you get your U.S. history out of the way through AP courses, and you go to college and you don't have to take any history courses depending on what your major is. I think it's still really easy to insulate yourself from any curriculum of that nature. I think it's, I guess I just wanted to throw a comment out there. As a high school student, I was very interested in finding out more about what it was like to be a black person, but it was actually kind of hard. And I came this close to sitting at the black kids' table one day just being like, hi, what are you telling me about being a black person? But like, I don't know how that's going to go over. But then what happened was social media came along when I was in college, and slowly but surely as I grew up and ran around and made more friends, including black friends and people of different races, and I became their friend, and all of a sudden they're posting on Facebook, they're in real time, their responses to things like Ferguson, or their responses to things that, you know, all things that happened the last couple of years, particularly, it's on my mind, it's so fresh. And now finally, I've been exposed to what I was hoping to be able to somehow hear, which is their real reactions. But I've also been taking, I'm pretty green now, it's taken me so long to find out that black people edit themselves in most situations. Like, I work with many black people and they don't comment on the racial stuff in the middle of work. I mean, a lot of us don't comment about politics. But, you know, it's just, it's surprising me how hard it is to hear the other side, and I don't know where to go to hear the other side. Even though I'm you know, college educated person, I can go find books. I think I probably do more research on my own end. But like, actually, like, where do I go to hear somebody? I don't know where that is. And this is my very last comment, but like, there was a story on NPR about the Truth and Reconciliation Commissions in South Africa. And I was so drawn to that idea. I mean, it sounds very hard, and I think they were coming much more recently out of a very clear racial situation, but I was like, can we ever do something like that in America with what even, you know, even with slavery having been, you know, as far back as it was, could we still yet have something like that? Could we still yet have something that's like very specifically geared toward nationally addressing something like that? And I don't know, like, that appeals to me, but maybe I'm a very odd person, I don't know.
I don't know if we could do a true reconciliation commission in the United States, according to the slavery so long ago. And especially part of the reconciliation commission did was actually assess punishment. Well, we're not going to assess punishment for slavery that happened 150 years ago, for obvious reasons. I think part of what I am saying is to have that in place. Why do people give themselves two racial conversations? You know, what that's the thing I found is that everybody has, no one wants to really, only a few people are dumb enough to really go out there and say this is racial issues, and I'm one of those for you. So, you know, we all add ourselves to some degree on racial issues. And part of what I'm trying to talk about is, can we have an atmosphere where we don't have to do that because the other person's trying to figure out where we're coming from. Now, what does that actually look like? You know, that's, I honestly struggle with that. You know, I'm talking about, you know, taking a friend to lunch, I'm talking about, you know, having groups sit down and try to communicate maybe over weeks of time. I don't know exactly what that looks like. I do feel that if we decided that this was important to us as a society, we figure it out. It will look different in the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. That was a unique situation in a unique time. But it may accomplish a lot of the same things. So part of what I'm saying is, okay, maybe my ideas of how it works isn't going to work exactly correct. I fully, you know, my ego's not hurt, but that happens. But I do think my ideas of trying to find ways in which we can create an atmosphere where we can listen to each other, I do think that that's what we really need. And trying to figure out how to get there is the challenge.
Just a question regarding testing of just sitting down with someone with a different ethnic or racial background.
No, different. It's differently.
Different?
Yeah, someone who has a different perspective on race.
Different perspective.
Yes.
Okay. Is that in talking about the issue, do you tend to bypass the person? But my question is, wouldn't it be more interesting to find out who is this person that is sitting across from me? With whom I have deep and abiding differences.
Yeah.
The differences at this point would seem somewhat clear that they may not be. I may assume that. But again, who is this person? For instance, hearing African American dads telling their kids, their teenagers, about how to behave if they're stopped by a police officer. I mean, it's a white kid growing up in California in the 50s and 60s. Hearing that is like, what? Those kinds of experiences, that kind of a background is more personal rather than the how I think or how this person thinks about it. I'm just wondering, is there a mix?
Yeah, there probably would be. I mean, this person I'm assuming is in your social network, so you already know something about them, but you know, it may be a relative, maybe a high school friend, or you know, maybe something like that. It seems to me that, you know, when you start asking people for why they feel the way they do, or what did they experience, I think we can get into some of that. And maybe I'm expecting too much of folks in that, you know, these are questions I would ask if I'm interviewing someone. When I interview people on a topic, I don't just ask for their stock opinion. I want to know how to share their opinion, what's brought about, what their experiences are there, to help them to develop that opinion. So maybe I need to write a little pamphlet on how to actually do this. But really, I think it will be mixed in there. It's going to be contextualized. You know, there are people who it's close to their best friend, and they violate these kinds of issues. So you already know this person's background. Other people, it may be someone that you don't know that well, and maybe, you know, you need to spend like some conversation just to get to know them a little bit deeper. To allow questions to be something that is really pertinent to them. So I think it's a very valid question. There's no, obviously, no set answer to it. It's just depending on the situation.
We have time for one more question, and then we are going to tell you all how to get to Middle House for dinner. So you're all invited. Invitations open to everyone. So one more question.
So now, many of these racial issues, you have these stereotypes and strong opinions. And you have a lot of people who really just don't want to bother with the issue at all. So how can, what advice would you suggest on how to engage people who probably don't really want to think about these issues at all?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, my personality is I don't want to drag someone into an issue that they don't want to drag into because that doesn't do any good. It just may be a case of is the way that person is ready to deal with an issue. Because I don't know any reason why to drive someone into an issue that they don't want to deal with. Now, I think in the case that they should care about this issue, and maybe that's where, you know, maybe that's where the conversation is at that point. Chances are someone like that, though, probably isn't strongly into all lives or black lives. Like, they're just, you know, they're into something else. Probably kind of neutral on those individuals. But then again, they're kind of the ones who are driving the conflict either. So maybe if the people who are really passionate care, or, you know, are the ones in the conversations, the ones who aren't, you know, who kind of have more drives their attitude, probably just accept the outcome. So, you know, it's interesting to feel a little bit more about it. My inclination is that, you know, if someone really doesn't want to get involved in it, and, you know, just like I said to the person who you're actually listening, you don't have to listen to me, you don't have to talk about me.